it seems that it ends with an anti-climax. There's all the hype, the red carpet receptions, the motorcades and the ticker tape parades, dramatic protests and confrontations on the streets of Jerusalem, then back to the motel at the outskirts of the city to call it a day. The ending doesn't seem to fit the hype of the day and the excitement of the crowd. After 3 years of public work proclaiming the kingdom of God and of the need to turn back to God and of Jesus healing and doing other signs and wonders and preaching forgiveness and mercy, Jesus rides an enormous wave of public popularity into the capital city of his people. The roar of the crowds is deafening. Hosanna to the Son of David! This crowd is louder than the MCG at the finals. This crowd is like that because they've been living under the shadow of Rome for decades. For entire generations, they had endured the rule of their latest brutal governor, who lined their highways with their crucified citizens, their brothers and sisters, their mums and dads, left there to rot until their bodies fall at last to the ground. They've also endured the murderous regime of Herod's, who the Romans had backed, a regime that was willing to murder every last child in a town just to make sure they stayed in power. This crowd roared, for the King of Israel had finally come, and a prophet no less, who had the very power of God himself to heal the sick, raise the dead, walk on water. Rome and the Herods were about to be wiped from the map. Or so they thought. They were so excited about Jesus, they gave him the shirts off their backs, literally. They pulled their shirts off and threw them in his road so that he wouldn't have to walk on the dust. Jesus receives the praise because in all reality, he is the King of Israel, the Son of God. But what does he do with this kind of political power? Instead of leading the crowd to Pilate's headquarters or Herod's palace, he does something really strange. He takes a turn and leads them all to the temple, where he stops worship in its tracks. Have you ever watched a footy game or some other sporting match when suddenly the game stops out of the blue and you think, what is happening? And then it turns out, yep, a streaker has run onto the pitch. Jesus kept his clothes on, but the effect he had in the temple on that day is exactly the same. He wasn't making a comment about the sacrificial system necessarily. Jesus wanted their attention, especially the religious leaders, in the most gripping way. It'd be the same if Jesus wandered in here and tore the altar cloth off the table with all the vessels and all the stuff for communion in the middle of communion and threw it to the floor. He would have our undivided attention, wouldn't he? He says, it is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. I always get frustrated with people who translate things into English. They have so many words and yet they seem to fall into some lazy habits to steer things in certain directions. The word here for robber is one who seizes by violence, in contrast to a thief who sneaks in and pinches his stuff while you're not looking. This word is also translated elsewhere and most often as an insurrectionist or violent revolutionary who will use violent force to get what they want. So when we read the word robber, we just think, oh, someone's going to pinch his stuff. No, we're talking about terrorists. Jesus said, it is written, My house shall be called a house of prayer, but you're making it a den of violent revolutionaries. The temple, the heart of national life, should be a place where people could come and encounter the living God, who rescued them out of slavery and is bringing them into freedom. Instead, it had become the heart of violent revolutionary longings of the nation. Through the leadership of the temple, the whole nation was on an almost inevitable and irreversible path to a violent showdown with Rome, one that would see them utterly slaughtered, that would see the nation end as a smouldering rubbish heap like Gehenna, the rubbish dump that's always out on fire on the edge of Jerusalem, and which becomes for Jesus in his repeated sermons the place where you never want to wind up, which we commonly translate as hell, Gehenna. Jesus, in all he was doing and saying over 3 years, and now with his attention-getting protest, was calling the nation to turn away from their path of destruction and turn back to God, to follow his way of peace and his way of militant, non-violent resistance of evil. To underline the fact that this was a house of prayer and not a violent revolution, the folks usually excluded from society, like the blind and lame, came to him in the temple, a place where they are usually forbidden. And Jesus healed them, and even the children praised his work. To underline his way of peace, Jesus, instead of seizing power, quietly ends the day by going back to his motel room without further ado. To underline his way of peace, he would lead a crowd up another hill a week later, the hill of the skull, and give up his life as he had lived it, as the man of non-violent action, as the Prince of Peace. Jesus says elsewhere, those who live by the sword will die by the sword. Sadly, the Jewish nation continued down its war path, and by AD 70 ended just as Jesus had prophesied, a smouldering rubbish heap. Jesus never countenances complicity with evil or capitulation to it. He teaches us the way of a vigorous, non-violent resistance to evil that may well cost us our own lives, but will never see us take another's. It's interesting to see that the people who took up the sword were destroyed, and they were never allowed to inhabit that land again until the late 1940s, nearly 2,000 years. God barred them from that land. But the people Jesus has established are the most common people now on the face of the earth. He has established a kingdom that has never been defeated, and his people are in the process of conquering the world with their love and mercy and grace. In a world where we continue to be witness to school shootings in what is supposed to be the most prosperous and Christian country on earth, where the Russians and the Ukrainians still kill each other, where the Chinese Communist Party would like to see us all dead so they can take our stuff and impose their way of life on everyone else that is left, starting with Taiwan, and the threat of violence abounds in every direction, the church does well to remember where such a path will lead humanity. It will lead us into the gates of hell. The church too often has fallen into the trap of supporting national identities and preaching war and violence. Our brothers and sisters in places like Syria, Taiwan, South Korea, North Korea, Ukraine, and Russia, and yes, even in amongst our own leadership, need our prayers to stay on the much more dangerous, much more narrow path of Jesus, the one that will lead us all the way to the cross and through the other side. They need our prayers not to fall into the temptation of fighting violence with violence. For those who live by the sword shall die by the sword. And we too need to be on our guard, lest we think violence is the solution to any of our world's problems. Jesus says to you today, my house shall be called a house of prayer. Amen.